Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're all really welcome to our third concert in our series of summer's evening concerts here at Scoil Glórsach at the Early Irish Harp Festival, which is in its 15th year, but in a new venue this year. And I know it's been tricky for some of you to find us, so thank you for making your way here and going to the trouble. Let us just begin. I think Eamon's going to introduce our first number, so I'll sit down and get involved in a tuning fest, as is usual for harpers. Thank you.
The main theme of our concert tonight are the music and songs associated with the two harpers from Sligo, Liam and Tomás O'Connellan, and another harper. They were 17th century primarily, and another man, Dominic O'Mungon, who was a harper from the 18th century from County Tyrone. And we're going to begin with two pieces that praise or commemorate a lady, Margaret. She was born Margaret Burke. She was one of the Clanricker Burkes in Galway. She married Viscount Iva McGuinness, and her husband fought on the wrong side of the Jacobite War in Ireland, and subsequently left Ireland, like many of the soldiers in the Jacobite army. They went to serve on the continent in various countries. They're known as na Gaeilge Fianna, or the wild geese. And indeed, later on this evening, Siobhan will be playing a piece there commemorating na Gaeilge Fianna. In any case, McGuinness died in, I think, 1695, and his wife, Margaret, married Thomas Butler of Kilcash in South Tipperary. And we heard Ailish singing the song Kilcash very beautifully yesterday, and with some trepidation, I'm going to try and sing it now. And again, so she lived with Thomas Butler. He was a nominal Protestant, but she was renowned for her hospitality, her generosity, her fairness with her tenants, and also for housing priests on the run and helping people get ordained and so on and so forth. So she was remembered very fondly by the people down there. They called her on Lady Vira, which is interesting, Lady Iva. I think she died around 1744. So we're going to play, I'm going to sing Kilcash,
and then I'll play Lady Iva of, which is by either William or Thomas Conlon. We're not so sure who it's by. So, but both pieces, of course, are related to Lady Iva. So Kilcash and Bán Tiarna Ivá, as she's known in Irish, Lady Iva.
Adi an mi faste gan naimed, adedn gaite loi, ni an thrafde gai cash na e tai lov, ni kere lain ra. An noi to the bonier an daivan, for bradam
Ansel, Ansel.
18th-century harper who was born probably in about 1715 and lived into the third quarter of the 18th century, was renowned for his very nuanced playing, from his pianissimi to his fortissimi, and his whispering notes, and all sorts of wonderful things were remarked about this harper. And one thing that I find pretty special about him is that he's a personification of how versatile the Irish harpers were in the 18th century. Because we think of them playing Irish tunes, but in fact, they were playing all sorts of tunes. So Dominic Mungan, his party piece was an aria from Handel's L'Allegro, il Penseroso ed il Moderato, which was the first oratorio of Handel's that was performed here in Ireland in 1741. And so I can imagine that the best tunes from that oratorio became quite well known in Dublin. And Dominic Mungan realised that one of them was quite diatonic. You could play it on a harp that couldn't be so chromatic as European Baroque music generally was at that period. So it became his party piece, Let Me Wander Not Unseen. And before that, I want to play something that we really don't associate with the early Irish harp, which are hymn tunes. Because another of his, you can't really say it's a party piece if it's a hymn tune, but apparently he loved playing Old Hundredth. And I think you'll recognise Old Hundredth when you hear it. So Old Hundredth followed by some Handel.
Thank you.
going to indulge myself a bit here, because this isn't, strictly speaking, a harping piece. This is a song composed by a Munster poet, Owen Roald Suleiman. He died as a young man. He was born in 1748, died in 1784. He's probably the most popular poet in Irish-speaking Munster in his own time and for a long time afterwards. He was known as Owen in Vail Veen, or Owen of the Sweet Mouth. And he spent his life working as a relatively destitute, as a migrant labourer. And he worked for a family, Barry's, in Castle Hyde, which is just outside Fermoy, very beautiful place on the banks of the Blackwater River. And these would have been a fairly prosperous family, and obviously his ability to write poetry and song allowed him a place in the big house. So he shared in the conviviality and the hospitality and the socialising that carried on. And the song is a lovely illustration of the hospitality and the entertainment that would go on in a big house in Ireland in the 18th century. That he partook of, and the playing of the harp is mentioned in it, among many other things. He had a little amorous indiscretion shortly after that, and he had to flee the area very quickly. And he composed this song, a farewell to Castle Hyde, Slán le Cathaoirí Éadan. And it's quite a long song. I'm just going to sing a couple of verses of it.
Slán agus tahil le cangil cearti gris, quam gac bail agus aitri vô cilla hi go fuin sin. An guant locht in ad lachting se bachis ge blifair, daunt len adis his pragar ocht fuin fard. Rink agus pleir ocht ag behiv gant las, Squivrinyl herge lem heif shegus av Gwy siad og gwy siembr Gwy sif sulfur choig His count loch his cach me Shalid in nir she Gohorach e tashtil Gan natis naivnes Mulhan se harenys y teil Gan liam gil Fair grover da bein o'ch dlan treir o'ch cwyn cil fawr. Roib sulfur sergel e ffeile dy rire, na taen tyg ffeistoch yn neil brwl y mi'n sild. Eich sen li cas clair drich egwys doif, treid hashtil tiare gaf ni egwys la, o be egwys si. Díl nín agus bárd, go fiantach go fiolvar, go bjórach go biavar, go líanvar go lónrach, go kjólvar go sín sách. Mulhán se chan sean fær gráver njav kinte, san tárne bøgnach e trach an simchrinn. Babyn y môn frolwch nôl y gysiche, sa'r finnau sa'r prytu roch yn hi'n pwl. Slan gwys gydle siarg ser chan liam, gros gan mwy tlif le cwyn ceil y licium, do fo byfyn glen traif cam yn hil, mylon sy'r condonol yn tog a slan difnes, Is the mosque that must orse the foping lady grace. Not long could impart a connard of O'Hale, connav, conshan, conmores, conshamwish. Slán con nel wán le cuin grás siart mi llefe, dil arsach I áver chiap naif agus eich se. Slán con an rôs dig fair cioffer go bín, lagardas de hogoch ga cioffri dem chri, o slán con ga hogla be is fat yarman, carigan ne de, o mon rida gassing, ni scaring lem relief.
Another Conlon tune this time. I think at least the jig to the jointure, if not the jointure itself, is by Thomas Conlon, one of the pair of brothers from County Sligo who were born in the 17th century and lived into the 18th century. So the jointure and jig, and then we'll follow that, but we'll probably give Eamon a second to get on stage. You don't have to dash on at the end of the jointure or anything. We'll give you Rebthwaite and Garrick of Mungan, so we'll go back to Dominic Mungan. So this programme is really sort of concentrating on the Conlons on one side and the Mungan on the other. So this is your latest ration of Conlon. Very, very typical to have a tune and to have a jig version of the tune following it at this period.
Thank you.
Eamon will sing now, which he'll tell you about, was really of interest to me when he mentioned it, because it's in the repertoire of Dominic Munkin. And it's not only in his repertoire, it was composed probably by Dominic Munkin. And I hadn't really twigged to this until Eamon and I started collaborating on this programme. So let's you tell them a little bit more about it. Maybe actually if I tell them what I knew, which you... No. Okay. It won't take long, Famous last words, never believe a harvest. I believed the story that we all think about this song in Ireland, which is that it's to do with penal times when Catholicism, there was also kinds of sectarianism in Ireland against Catholics and basically anybody who wasn't Anglican. So this was a veiled song about penal times and having to say the Mass in secret at Mass Rocks, which were in the countryside, on Reithwick and Gorrick. Were you at the Rock? Were you at the Mass Rock? But apparently, that's not true at all, as Eamon will now describe.
Yeah, well, it's a song, and a love song, or a song in praise of Eliza Blacker, who was the daughter of a family in near Portadown, in Carrick Blacker. And we've actually located a portrait of her, which
you have on your programmes.
Which we think is probably the only portrait we have of the object of a Gaelic love song. There's one thing I have to check with you.
Yes. I will play an instrumental verse. The fourth one. Before your fourth verse.
Yes,
exactly.
So between three and four.
Yes,
the first few verses of this would be quite well known to many people in Ireland, but I haven't heard other people sing the other verses. There are a few more, but we're going to sing four of them. And you're going to give me.
I will give you the dutiful notes.
Naro to ege garig, noe vape to hin mogra, noe vape to dili gospinje koishkivn ma, noe vape to antu. To Mo Valentine, no one will she at Limarheim. Nadi say, Galik, Gos Honig me in the raw. Honig Mishe Gili, Gos Finne. Ishkivna, oh, Hanik Mishe Antul, oh, Huide Spovilche Bla, Hanik Mishe Do Valentin, ach, Nilchi Atli Marha. Nuere vince im halle, tagen nos negan dim liv. Snem li edich noch iv, godike angirin nir. Naru
Shorter than the introduction, for sure, because there's a little bit to say about this. Normally, Irish music is collected in such a way that the tunes wind up in one set of manuscripts, and the words are collected separately, usually in a far distant part of the country, and wind up in a different manuscript. So we generally have the problem with older sources, how to reconcile those two, and it's usually quite problematic. So imagine my astonishment when a few months ago, one of my Baroque music colleagues, Peter Whelan, the Irish Baroque bassoonist, sent me an email and he said, well, look, I'm researching this program for music for Dublin Castle in the early 18th century. And those of you who are locals, I don't know if any of you made it to the concert that he did of that program, Kenny Arts Festival, a few nights ago, but it was really stunning to hear all this music that we knew had been composed but that we hadn't been able to hear and evaluate before. So the master of the king's music in Ireland, this position was held by Johann Sigmund Kuso in the late 17th and into the early 18th century, and afterwards it was taken over by Matthew Dubourg, who was a very fine fiddle player and in fact led the orchestra for the premier performance of Messiah in Dublin that Handel directed. And in fact, Handel and Dubourg were really good friends. And I think Dubourg was the only person that Handel left money to. He was the only musician that Handel left money to in his will. So I think we can say they were really quite close. So Peter rang me and he said, look, I'm looking at all these manuscripts of Matthew Dubourg, where he's composed, because he was a composer as well, he composed all these rather sycophantic odes for the Lord Lieutenant and the King and whoever else was likely to come across them. But he said, I've come across a page of music, vocal music, and he said, it's not English, it's phonetic, so I think it's Irish, can you figure out what it was? So I sorted that one out. I said, yeah, we know this piece well, it's a harper song, it's Kishtanos Thor. And then he sent me another one. And he said, well, what about this one? So this was from the commonplace book. And a commonplace book is where you write everything from, you know, your recipes to your tunes to Lord knows what in the 18th century. This was the commonplace book of Johann Sigmund Kuso. And he's in among the recipes for hangovers and how much it costs to put on a concert in Dublin and all sorts of interesting things. There was this little fragment of a tune, and again, the words written underneath it in phonetic Irish and a translation in English. And Peter didn't know what it was, so he said, what's this one? I said, oh, yeah, we know this one well. This is Sian Shias agus Suslam, a very well-known piece in the 18th century, which shows up in all sorts of sources. But this was the first time I'd seen the words under the notes in the same way as I had for Kishtanos Thor. So Peter gave me not one, but two amazingly interesting pieces. So one of them we'll do for you today. If you come back next year, we'll promise to do Kishtanos Thor. But we're still working through the Irish for that one. So here we are. Sian Shias agus Suaslam, Kuso's version. It also shows up in the Bunting manuscripts, in the harp manuscripts at the end of the 18th century, and in many other places. Thank you. One of the great lamentations in Irish music, sometimes called Ireland's Lamentation, and with good reason, because every 100 years or so we lose. We're not very good at battles and wars, the Irish, so we lose at the end of the 16th century and we lose at the end of the 17th century. So our history is really rather unfortunate, seen from our own viewpoint. So this history spawns many beautiful laments, and this is the lament at the end of the 17th century, and Eamon alluded to it at the beginning when he talked about the wild geese and the Jacobite wars, in which Lady Iva's husband died. So this is a tune for all of those fallen at the end of the 17th century, na Gé Fiona, or the wild geese.
Thank you.
which Conlon writes what, so I always have to look it up at the last minute. Okay, so Molly McAlpine is a song by William Conlon, a very beautiful love song. So thank you all for being with us this evening. We have a really wonderful concert tomorrow evening with James Ruff, who's making his debut here at the festival playing. And his guest is Ronan Brown, the really exceptional Irish piper. And I don't just mean musically. I mean, he's an institution in his own right. We've had a wonderful class with him here today, and he'll be back playing tomorrow. So if you're around at all and you'd like to join us, please do. So thank you very much.
Oh, my goodness.